Wow, what a beautiful moth. Incredible. This is a viewer's choice episode. We are going to breed Wicana lindia, a rare moth from Asia. And I'm going to tell you all about his life history and how I managed to raise them in captivity. Welcome to another episode of Moth Cycles. This episode was voted for by my Patreon subscribers. Stop. Before we begin, this channel is completely demonetized by YouTube. I don't make any money from this channel except for what people donate to me. So I decided to let all my Patreons, the people who donate to me on Patreon, vote in a poll. And the poll is as follows. What will Moth Cycles episode number 7 be about? And people could vote on 4 species. Paonias miops, the small-eyed sphinx moth. Limantria dispar, the gypsy moth. Caligula lindia. And Amata mogadorensis, the wasp moth. And the result of our vote is... Caligula lindia, according to the poll that I have here. This is a viewer's choice episode. You guys voted for this. If you haven't joined my Patreon yet, you are missing out, because in the future you can vote on what species of moth I will breed on this channel. Now let's start the intro. Of a rare moth species that not everyone will get to study in their lifetimes. But of course, Bart Coppens, the Mothman, will do it. Because I get all this cool stuff that no one else can breed. The eggs are creamy white and slightly round, yet oval. I hatch these eggs in a petri dish as usual. Next, it's possible to rear the tiny babies on a variety of plots. In this video, I have been raising a group of them on betula or birch and in very well ventilated containers. Another group of them I have been raising on Prunus spades or European bird cherry. They do not seem to be very picky. They'll also eat poplar tree, sweet gum, oak tree, honeysuckle willow and other food plants. They prefer to be somewhat warm and dry, although they appreciate being sprayed sometimes to have a drink. Often they rest on leaves, in a curled position that resembles the letter J. In this position they rest most of the time, although often they will resume their activities to feed. Inside their tiny containers, they were growing relatively fast. When I checked the baby caterpillar several days later, they had already grown into instar number 2. This is instar number 2. Can you see the difference? They do look almost the same as instar 1. Almost, but not entirely. Their tubercules are now much more pronounced, and the tubercules near their head now have black tips, I suppose. It's always nice when they make it to the second instar without much issues. Pretty soon, the second instar looked already ready to shed its skin to the next phase of its life. Let's see what it looks like in instar 3. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here in the garden, taking care of all the insects. And now I am going to take a look at the Caligula / Wicana lindia. See how they are doing. I see some of them have significantly grown. So let me offer you some close-ups of this really nice species that you don't see in captivity very often.
Check this out.
Oh wow, that's pretty cool. Their behind seems to have a colorful orange patch now, and they still look healthy. I'm glad to see them making progress like this. Hicana lindia, or formerly Caligula lindia, is a pretty unusual species in the moth hobby, so it's important for me to succeed with them. They are very hard to get. I probably just have one chance to study this species. So are you ready to see instar number 4? I bet you are. Get ready, here they are. This is instar number 4. What's very interesting is that in this life stage, the caterpillars have two markings on their behinds that almost resemble fake eyes. Potentially these fake eyes intimidate or misdirect predators away from their head. It's interesting to say the least. So far, so good. I was still raising several groups of them at the same time. And both of the groups on birch tree and poplar tree leaf and the group on birch cherry grew very well. I suppose they are not very picky when it comes to their diet and develop well on several kinds of plants. Oh, by the way, this video is going to be a little bit faster than usual because some people complain that my Moth Cycles episodes can be too long. So I'm trying to experiment with faster pacing. Caligula lindia are now in a big cage. Yes, I put them in a big cage. Very special species, not something you can see on other YouTube channels. Very unique. Let's see the progress. I really want to know how they are doing and how they are developing. And this is the final instar. Wow, instar number 5. Very unique looking caterpillars, don't you guys agree? They are still lime green, with hairs, and white tubercules and fake eye spots on their butts. There is only one single generation a year, and the cocoons of this species always hibernate. So when they spin cocoons soon, we must make sure to hibernate those in a cool environment until next spring. Around June, the moths usually emerge in their native habitat and larvae feed on several types of woodland trees like maple, walnut, birch, pear, willow, poplar tree and others. They do enjoy being sprayed with water once in a while so they can drink as long as the water is allowed to evaporate later. The development from egg to cocoon takes about 5 to 7 weeks, depending on the quality of the food and the temperatures too. This is a rare species, you know. I mean, you don't see these in captivity very often. Seem to be growing well on the cherry, but I'm nervous for them. I really want them to be able to grow to cocoons. Looks like this one is a bit camera shy. Beautiful larva of Caligula lindia. A medium-sized saturnid. These ones came from Pakistan. Just look at that. Really nice larva. And this is the final instar. It's still small, but if it's gonna eat a lot, soon they're going to make a cocoon, I hope. With your help, this channel can raise awareness for rare and unusual species of moths. I work together with various entomologists, butterfly farms and other institutions that help their conservation. Supporting this channel means supporting insects. This species is a species that's very difficult to find any information about on the internet, for example. And with each video I make and each article I write, I spread more easily accessible information to those who are really interested in insects and learning about their life cycles. Now soon the caterpillars are ready to spin a cocoon. Do you want to see it? Guess what, party people? My caterpillars have made cocoons. And I harvested the cocoons from their cage. You're probably very curious to see what a cocoon of this moth that people rarely get to breed looks like. So let me show you the harvest that we have. These are some of the first cocoons. Yay! I cut them open so I could inspect their health. The pupas seem fine, however. The cocoons of this species must hibernate until the next spring. So now let's prepare the overwintering box. I overwinter them in a very large plastic container filled with vermiculite. Vermiculite is magic for overwintering. This is my basement. In winter it's around 10 degrees Celsius here, but frost-free. In here the bugs can stay until next spring and the cold temperatures will suppress the moths and prevent them from coming out of their cocoons anytime soon. Now that's great, we just need a lot of patience, I suppose. Winter is a very, very boring time for my YouTube channel. I usually take a break because all my species hibernate. In spring, however, when weather was finally becoming warmer, it was time to warm up the cocoons. Are you ready to see the moths? Oh yeah, the moths are coming. Be patient. Wow, so this is the female of Ricana lindia. Look at the beautiful red eye spots contrasting with its grey camouflage. This moth is simply outstanding. Another incredible species on my YouTube channel. Currently you are looking at a female specimen of this wonderful species. The female can be identified with her small antennae and broader wings in general. She's also much larger than the males. These moths do not feed and only live for about 2 weeks time before they pass. In that time they just mate and lay eggs, essentially. In comparison, here is a male. Can you see the difference? It is subtle, but they are absolutely different when it comes down to it. The males have feathered antennae, for example, and smaller, more narrow wings. The females often passively wait for the males to arrive. It is the male's job to locate the female. Males track females down by their scent, or their pheromones essentially. Moths use their antennae to smell, and that is why the females have small antennae compared to the males, since it's the male's job to sniff down the female, so to speak. The males, however, are quite small in comparison with the female. Oh my god, ladies and gentlemen. Oh my god. Finally, the Ricana lindia are coming out of their cocoons. And my god, they are so beyond beautiful. Look at those colors. The shape, the size. But above all, the red eye spots on its hind wings. That's pretty spectacular, if you ask me. This is a species the average breeder will probably never get to breed, because they are pretty hard to get. So that only makes me more lucky. Wow, and this is a male. Females are much bigger and even have even more colorful eye spots, but wow, just look at that. The fact it's shivering means that it's wanting to fly away soon. So for that reason, I'm going to take it back indoors so it can pair with a female and not escape. Wow, wow, wow. So now it's time to try and pair these moths with each other. Turns out, however, that's really easy to do. Males and females will very easily pair in small cages. Wow, we did it! The life cycle of a rare moth species. Ta-da! Have we done a good job? I'm saying yes. It's currently spring and the Caligula moths, or sorry, Ricana, are coming out of their cocoons. And they are mating so that the next generation is ensured. Just look at their beauty. They're absolutely gorgeous, absolutely beautiful. Everything about them is pretty amazing if you ask me. The shape, the color, the pattern, this is perfection. And I found out they are really easy to pair. See this one, this is actually a mating. I don't know if they're going to stay attached, but these are actually mating. Can you see it? It's a male and a female in the process of pairing. They started pairing last night almost automatically. Some of these are females that are already mated. See, there you go. So that means, yeah, the next generation of the Caligula / Ricana lindia, it is on its way. Unfortunately, the males of this species are ultra nervous. They are really beautiful, but really nervous. It's very hard to film them for that reason. Let's see if I can even get a close-up. As you can see, some of them are missing pieces from their wings. That's because these males are so nervous, it's hard to have a perfect specimen, because they will move a lot, they will flap a lot. And the flying and flapping, it tears their wings, it wears them down. To the point where they will have minor wing damage. They do seem to have some very nice individual variety. Although it's incredibly difficult, really, to get these insects to cooperate. Just look at how easily they are stressed out. It's pretty insane. For that reason, I should probably place them back into their respective cages soon. See, it's just insane. There's little I can do about that. See? They're just like flopping fish. So, yeah, this is a species you don't want to stress, because they are just going to go all over the place. I'm gonna place them back into their cage and let them have matings tonight. Bye bye. Alright people, so in this big cage here behind me, the moths have been pairing. And they're even starting to lay eggs. In a few days, I just hope to collect all the eggs and hatch them and see what happens. Life cycle completed? I'm thinking so. Time to collect the eggs. This species will lay hundreds of eggs easily. They even pair in cold temperatures. Rest in peace, rest in peace. You know, moths are fascinating creatures, but they are actually horrible pets. To enjoy raising moths, you have to be really crazy about moths, otherwise you're going to have a bad time. This is like a year of work, a year of rearing to produce animals that only live for 2 weeks. And these are basically already dead. Some of them are half alive, but this is the end of it. This is the end. Not all of them are dead yet, I suppose. Some of them are like half alive. Alrighty. 2 weeks later, the eggs are going to hatch into little baby caterpillars. Are you excited? Ah, there you go. The life cycle of another species of moth completed. The babies are coming out finally. I'm so proud to have raised this hard to obtain species and rare silk moth on my channel. Thank you so much for watching. Life cycle completed! Life cycle completed. We did it. And I am happy because Lycana lindia is a species of silk moth that very little people will get to raise in their lifetime. In fact, almost nobody has raised this Saturnid, and I am one of the few that did. Another victory for Bart Koppens on YouTube. Another life cycle complete of a rare species of insect. Thank you guys for watching. And now we are going to make the transition to the educational part of my video. You see, you're watching a video series online called Moth Cycles. And Moth Cycles is my online web series in which we breed moths from egg to adult. We raise them in captivity. And then we have an educational part about their biology, so you have a complete rundown of their ecology, what they eat, where they live. And after watching this series, all of your questions should be answered. Let's go. Lycana lindia, or formerly Caligula lindia, is a wonderful species of Saturnid moth from Asia. Rarely studied by biologists, it was wonderful to have these on my channel and complete their life cycle successfully. Today I will educate you about their ecology. So where does this moth occur in the wild? This species has been recorded in Pakistan, Afghanistan, China, Nepal, Bhutan and India. The reason it's found in this list of countries is because this is a Himalayan species of insect. Along the Himalayan mountain range, the insects can be found from a lower to higher elevations. They are found around 2000 meters to 5000 meters altitude. Pairing usually takes place after midnight and the moths generally stay together until the following evening. Most eggs are deposited the first night. And the adult moths live 3 to 7 days, which is not very long. In the wild, caterpillars eat sea buckthorn and their relatives, birches, poplar tree, honeysuckle and walnut. However, they are more likely to eat even more species of plants, since in captivity they demonstrate a high degree of polyphagous feeding habits, and in the wild, different populations seem to prefer different plants. The flight time of this species is different in many countries. For example, in Bhutan, they have been recorded around April, in Pakistan in June and July, and in parts of India, they fly around August instead. However, in each of these countries, they do seem to have just one generation per year, and the cocoons more or less always hibernate and wait for the next spring in order to turn into moths, just like how I hibernated my cocoons of this species in this video. A recent taxonomic paper has revised the status of several emperor moths from the Saturnia taxonomic group. And if you want to know what makes the difference, it makes sense if you look at the geographic distribution. As you can see, Caco Saturnia, Ricana Saturnia, Neoris Perisomena, Callo Saturnia and Agapema have different distribution ranges and are actually different groups of moths based on their DNA and morphological differences. The group of Caligula moths in the Himalayas are supposedly unique. I've had a look at the original paper, Systematics and Biogeographic Reciprocally Illuminate Taxonomic Revisions in the Silk Moth Genus Saturnia, published in the Journal of the Lepidopterist Society. I think the paper is very solid and uses very convincing evidence to make most of these taxonomic changes. I also like the fact that nuclear DNA was used instead of mitochondrial DNA, which in my opinion is a more reliable method. However, I did notice something interesting and I quote, "Due to the lack of nuclear DNA data available for Caco Saturnia, we caution against drawing extensive conclusions from the current work regarding its precise phylogenetic placement. However, we are confident, based on the DNA sequence we used and the extensive ecological and morphological work of others, that it is a monophyletic group. In simpler terms, for the Caco-Saturnia group, more extensive data to support this change is actually partially missing, but the available data, even though more limited, supports this taxonomic change. They do appear to have distinct biogeographic and evolutionary histories. Anyways, that was all I have to say about it today. Considering that later we plan to make a bigger video about the taxonomy and biology of Saturninae family moths that includes all the details, so I can try to limit the length of this video. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bart Koppens After Dark. Dark conditions, isn't it? I hope you guys enjoyed the life cycle of this very rare silk moth species that very little people have ever studied. The Ricana lindia, formerly Caligula lindia. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you guys have truly enjoyed watching the life history of a very rare species of silk moth that very little people have actually ever studied or raised in captivity. But of course, Bart Koppens has done it. I would like to thank all of you for watching my channel. It means a lot to me. My name is Bart Koppens and I'm an online entomologist that studies butterflies and moths, and I have a YouTube channel that raises awareness for their conservation, their protection in the wild, and also for how to breed them in captivity. Now, before we end the video, I must remind you of something. YouTube has completely and utterly, completely demonetized my channel. When I upload a video on YouTube, I don't make a single dollar from it. Even if I got millions of views and millions of subscribers, it wouldn't matter to me. All the money I make from YouTube is crowdfunded, donations. Some people who watch my channel, who like the show, they tip me, they send me like a dollar or even a few more dollars because they like my videos. It's like tipping somebody for a service that you like. My channel is completely demonetized from YouTube, so for me it's important to remind people of the crowdfunding because it's the only way I can continue making videos. It's only the budget that my fans and viewers and subscribers have generously provided to me. It's the only reason I can keep making videos. So if you like my videos, if you want to see more of this stuff, if you want to see more videos on my channel, subscribe to our Patreon, donate via PayPal, or various other means that are in the description below this video. To me, it's very important to do the crowdfunding. See you guys later. Bye bye. This YouTube channel is demonetized. If you are interested in insects, please consider supporting it. All the funds I raise online are used for the conservation of insects, breeding and researching insects, and the production of entertaining and educational insect videos. Bye bye, see you next time.
Yeah, nobody can convince me that this is not an incredible species, because they are. They really are incredible. All the way from Pakistan to the Netherlands, can you believe that? Wow. It's the red eye spots for me that make them really beautiful.